So I'm very pleased to introduce our next speaker. Wendy Brown is currently Emanuel Heller Professor of Political Science at UC Berkeley and the author of 5 books, which I think are listed somewhere in the program, so I'm not going to name them, is one of the leading political theorists in the US today and one whose work enjoys a broad interdisciplinary readership. Most of you are probably already familiar with at least some of Wendy's writings. Rather than try to summarize what's an incredibly rich and wide-ranging body of work, by way of introduction, I'm going to focus on 2 elements of her theoretical practice that I find most distinctive. The first of these is a critical diagnostic element that's fundamental to the labors of any critical theorist. What I think distinguishes Wendy's approach to this task is what I might describe as its punctual or interventionist quality. While each of the books lays out a general problematic, the chapters often begin with carefully targeted interventions into quite specific dilemmas of political thought or practice. So the problem of the always expanding subject of women's studies in relation to its academic institutionalization, or the problem of the deep democratizing effects of neoliberal political rationality, particularly once it meets neoconservatism, the question of the political utility of rights claims. These local problems and questions are then refigured in ways that shift the analysis to another register. So in one of my favorite chapters in the book, Edgework, begins with the problem of producing political critique in moments hostile to its message, and then proceeds to a more expansive discussion of critical theory's temporalities, what it means to be timely and untimely in thought. Together, these interventions offer a remarkably original and productive mapping of the forces that constitute the political present and the subjects that live and struggle within their frame. These mappings, it seems to me, do the equally important political work of helping to orient us with arrows that indicate we are here, and to disorient us when it's not where we thought we wanted to be. This diagnostic element of the work includes as well critical engagements with some forms of political response to these forces, ostensibly resistant political agendas, practices, and discourses that may prove more complicit with than subversive of the modes of power they seek to contest, from state-centered feminist agendas to codes of politicized identity constituted by wounded attachments to the deployment of tolerance discourses. But in addition to these guides to the political present, guides that indicate as well some of the exits that may be blocked or not help us get very far out of the place we're in, one can also find in Wendy's work a second element in its moments of affirmation and gestures to the future. These figures of possibility in the work do not take the form of full-scale visions or prescribed norms. The mappings don't include exit plans or blueprints of an outside. They emerge rather as brief jolts and fragments, as glimpses of being, doing, or wanting differently that might serve, to borrow one of Wendy's formulations, to fuel rather than haunt or taunt left political life in our time. Here one can think of the way that the notion of freedom, and not the liberal version, appears frequently in the work, both as a tool of critical analysis and as a horizon of political desire and possibility. Her inclusion of affirmation, possibility, and potential in the vocabulary of critical theory is for me invaluable. And thus I find in Wendy's account of what theory does an apt description of her own critical practice. Theory, as she describes it, this is also an Edgework, quote, violates the self-representation of things in order to represent those things and their relation, the world, differently. Theory's most important political offering is this opening of a breathing space between the world of common meanings and the world of alternative ones, a space of potential renewal for thought, desire, and action. This is, I think, political theory, or more broadly, thinking politically at its best, at its most rigorous and most provocative. Her talk this evening is titled, Whose Secularism, Whose Equality? For a Return to the Critique of the Family. Please join me in welcoming Wendy Brown.
Thank you. It was a lovely introduction, and I have really come to appreciate the entire, I don't want to call it genre, the practice. Maybe it's the norms and standards of introductions at Duke. what they reveal, unlike a lot of places, like the one I come from, is that people actually read here. And it's marvelous. And I also feel that more generally, for those of you who are just new to the Feminist Theory Workshop, I've been here for several weeks as a visiting scholar. And one of the reasons this is such an astonishingly rich intellectual world, I think, has to do with the fact that you read. But also the fact that you produce and come to events like this and so forth. And so that's just a long-winded thank you for that substantive introduction. I found myself interested in the person you were introducing. And then I realized she had to perform. I also want to just take a moment to say thank you to Ranji for inviting me to this extraordinary event. I will be begging for an invitation to come back as a participant, not as a speaker. And to the staff, especially Lillian Spiller, from whom I've heard more often than almost anybody in my life over the last few months. And I've come to look forward to it because I knew there was nothing I couldn't ask her, including, you know, like where the 7-Eleven was. So anyway, Lillian Spiller is, as everybody in this room knows, amazing as an organizer and facilitator of events like this. It's also my deep pleasure to be here with And it's finally my deep pleasure to be here with Nefertiti, Drusilla, and Tani, people whose work I admire, some of whom are close friends, and it's just a pleasure to be doing this with you all. So, okay. This talk emerges from a set of concerns. A lot of equipment up here, including a telephone.
We need that for the video.
Oh. Yeah. It's always a... Just skip the feminist joke. It's a performative contradiction, skipping that joke. Okay, let's settle. I did not drink. You guys maybe did, but I did what I was supposed to do at dinner. This talk emerges from a set of concerns that are going to seem quite disparate at first, and I promise you that they are connected. I connected them as I wrote the talk, but they pull together. You'll also see some convergences, not in locale, not in idiom, not in object of analysis, but convergences at the level of politics and analytics with Nefertiti's talk, and I was delighted to see those convergences. So that means this is all working. Okay, so the set of concerns that are going to seem very disparate at first blush. The first one is the presumption that secularism produces gender equality. The second concern animating this talk is the presumption that secularism divests public life of religious values. The third concern in the talk is the sacred status of the family in contemporary US culture. And the fourth has to do with things that have been gnawing at me about the gay marriage campaign and also the worship of the Obama family. So those are the things kind of animating this, and I'm going to be linking these in an argument that I must say in advance offers a critique of each, but as I do so, I want to make two requests of you as thinking participants in this endeavor. And the first one is just to remember that critique is not a rejection or a call for abolition or destruction of its object. Critique doesn't condemn, as I understand it, but attempts to grasp the constitutive powers and the connections of its object or its scene of analysis. Moreover, critique doesn't necessarily answer the question, what is to be done, something Kathy warned you that I'm not really very good on, but I'm happy to work on it with you afterwards. So the first thing I want to ask as we move into this talk is just to remember that as I'm being very hard on certain things, that doesn't mean I'm trying to kill them. I'm really trying to open them up. It's my way of doing it. And the second is that my focus is unapologetically the United States, and that's because I'm trying to figure something out about this political culture, and that doesn't mean that there aren't resonances and and transits out and in. It doesn't mean that I actually believe in the solidity and the availability as a as an obdurate object of analysis, the nation state, but I am trying to think through something about U.S. political culture. So, again, I'll invite you to make connections elsewhere, but I just am trying to stave off the, how come you're just talking about the United States? Because I'm talking about the United States. Okay, so, and that doesn't mean I think it's the most important thing in the world. I'm partly talking about the United States because I'm trying to figure out something about discourses of imperialism, and some of those discourses emanate from here. While we absorb ourselves in debates about recovering from the disasters wrought by neoliberal and neoconservative hegemony over the past quarter century, like what's the best way to save capitalism, what's the best way to walk away from the mess that we've made in Iraq, what's the best way to end torture and extra-constitutionalism and rendition and so forth, I think we should not lose sight of the persistent but less dramatic formations that nearly 25 years of hegemony by the neoconservatives has wrought. And I'm stretching it from Reagan forward with the assumption that the Clinton thing made a fair interruption but didn't really bring it down. Much in our political discourses about the world, about the place of the United States in it, about religion, about family, about democracy, remains contoured by that hegemony, even when we think we're speaking against it, speaking in a progressive or counter voice. One of the minor accomplishments of the neocon regime was its perverse appropriation and equation of secularism, feminism, and equality. Even while neoconservatives in power opposed each of these in substance, and often tarred liberals through affinity with the substance, they still managed to co-opt the terms for their own purposes. They launched imperial regime change operations in the name of all three, that is, in the name of secularism, feminism, and equality. They cast the terrorist attacks on the US of 9/11 as born out of Islamicist opposition to all three. Supposedly, these things, along with wealth and freedom, were features of the American way of life that the terrorists were said to hate and want to destroy. So how did they do it? How did the Bushies do it? How did an expressly Christian administration, openly promulgating patriarchal family values and Christianity in public institutions and public life, committed to overt neoliberal inequalities spiced with racial and gender hierarchies, how did they manage to co-opt the language of feminist equality and political secularism? How, when they were rolling back such basic gender equality principles as equal pay for equal work, access to contraception and abortion, both domestically and abroad, women's ability to leave abusive relationships or troubled relationships without being economically punished, how did they manage to stand for gender equality? How, when they were promulgating school prayer, invoking Judeo-Christian values as the basis of the West and Western supremacy, exempting churches from taxes, conflating all Islam with terrorism, how did they manage to stand for secularism? And how, when the neocons so overtly circumvented constitutional protections and set aside scores of legal provisions, how did they manage to stand for the rule of law and cast the other as rogue, arbitrary, and theocratic? How, when they violated the most basic principles of even liberal democracy, fair elections and respect for their outcomes, and I'm not just talking about Florida butterfly votes, but also I mean, voter manipulation at home, surely, but the refusal to accept Hamas or Venezuelan socialism abroad, when they also violated the most basic principles of liberty, equality, representation, and rights, how did they manage to stand for democracy and identify themselves with worldwide promotion of this political form? And above all, what's the relation of all of these things that I've just listed? That is, what's the relation of each of these remarkable moves? What the Bushies were able to do, it seems to me, especially but not only in the aftermath of 9/11, was first of all draw on some very basic conceits about Western democracy as an a priori of the modern Euro-Atlantic West, as well as on some basic conceits about what comprises democracy: individualism, property rights and markets, religious tolerance, the formal rule of law, etc. What I mean is that one of the ways that it seems to me democracy operates today as a term of civilizational discourse is that democracy is considered a category that nation states are either in or out of. That is, the West is always already presumed democratic, nations within the West are always already democratic, and the rest of the world is positioned discursively in one of two inferior categories, either undemocratic or democratizing. That is, the non-West is positioned either as the radical other of democracy, undemocratic or anti-democratic, or it's in a temporal lag vis-a-vis democracy. So it's radical other or it's infant. Just as the Third World has for centuries, several centuries at least, been positioned in relation to civilization more generally in a civilizational discourse. That is, it's either the radical other or the constitutive outside or the primitive precursor of civilization, development, modernity, Europe, etc. This we know. But this discursive ordinance establishes the Euro-Atlantic West, the First World, as always already democratic, not democratizing, let alone de-democratizing, but simply arrived. It's the given. So what we're in the grip of here, and this is a really, again, a point that I think is fairly common knowledge in the room, what we're in the grip of is something Edward Said taught us to understand as an old Orientalist reflex in which we affirm ourselves as free and agentic and progressive by means of a discursive opposition in which the other is cast as unfree, subordinated by authority, and mired in timeless tradition. And that's a fiction, of course, that produces our identity and self-affirmation. It's about us. It doesn't have anything to do with an accurate representation, let alone ethnography, of the so-called other. But I want to add something to the Saidian account. What further entrenches and mobilizes this binary in a specifically contemporary fashion in the US, I think, has to do with the equation of the democratic and the secular, and the unfounded historical presumption that each realizes and develops the other. That is, that secularism is what makes democracy possible, and that democracy necessarily and inherently entails secularism and produces it. Joan Scott has actually authored a terrific recent paper called, it's impossible to pronounce, but I'll spell it for you. It's secularism, and it's because she was trying to write secularism, and she kept writing S-E-X instead of S-E-C, and then she realized that the Freudian slip was actually very telling, because we were mostly convinced, well, because she's actually wanting to argue that in no way historically has secularism produced sexual equality, nor was it ever part of its aim. But we'll get to that in a moment. So the thing I want to add to the Saidian account, first of all, is that we tend to equate the democratic and the secular. And when this is combined with the assumption that secular democracy is autonomous of theological, cultural, and economic content and powers, this resurrects the figure of the free collective and individual subject, that is, resurrects the figure of the autonomous and free state, as well as the autonomous and free individual, amidst transnational forces of capital and of governance that are eroding both, that are actually tearing at the autonomy and agency of both. What I'm trying to get at is that it's through the equation of the democratic and the secular, and through the assumption that democracy is produced out of secularism and that secularism entails democracy, that North Americans can continue to conceive of themselves as free and agentic subjects, even as evidence of our own de-democratization mounts. But it's these discursive coordinates that permit us to go on proclaiming our individual freedom and our collective democracy amidst ever-decreasing access to the powers that govern our lives and ever-declining possibilities for sharing in these powers, which I take to be very basic to any claim to democracy. That's this equation of secularism and democracy, the assumption that secularism is democracy and that we have, and that democracy entails secularism, that facilitates the phenomenon with which we begin. By presuming democracy, liberty, equality, autonomy, tolerance, rights, and the rule of law as what we always already have, and what they necessarily lack, the Bushes could very easily reinstate all the binaries between us and them of basic civilizational discourse. We're tolerant, they're intolerant. We're free, they live under authority. We have equality, they're submitting to hierarchy. We have rights, they have oppression. We have the rule of law, they have theocracy. Even as the Bushes routinely undid these binaries, manipulated them, and occupied both sides of them. The accomplishment, then, I'm suggesting, is almost overdetermined. On the one hand, the Bush accomplishment of appropriating feminism, secularism, and equality was orchestrated by an older set of discursive metonymic associations among the secular, the democratic, the free, the choosing, and the egalitarian. And on the other hand, the accomplishment was facilitated by mobilizing a civilizational discourse in which democracy is understood to require secularism and replace hierarchy and authority with equality. But this, what I'm calling overdetermination, means that the tasks for, and I'm just loosely going to call us progressives, even though the word is terrible, but I'm going to just leave it there because I could say the task for the left, the task for feminists, the task for, I could list all the signs under which you might hang if you were a progressive, but I'm just going to leave the big one there. That task for us, that was an us here, is to excavate and expose and interrupt rather than continue these practices that I'm saying are contoured by these multiple elements of civilizational discourse. When we treat, for example, the behaviors of the Taliban attacking girls headed for school as the dire opposites of our own, and here we have to ask, how recently have U.S. whites done this to blacks? How recently have Irish Protestants done this to Irish Catholics, and so on? But when we treat the behaviors of the Taliban as dire opposites of our own, or when we treat the headscarf as a symbol of patriarchy, of course semiotically multivalent, we've all learned to say that, perhaps, but still presumed to have no cousins in 6-inch heels and facelifts and bikini waxes and breast augmentation and so forth, or when we cast radical Islam as if it were more damaging to women's lives than neoliberal globalization, poverty, or imperial wars, all of these, I want to suggest, remain emanations of this worldview that I have just described. Just as the very rendering of fundamentalism as the opposite of secularism and theocracy as the very opposite of democracy is still part of this worldview. I'm not saying there are no differences. I'm interested in the discursive oppositions and what we get, what the West gets out of these oppositions. So what I'm suggesting is that while it's tempting to believe that having deposed the neocons in the last election, we're now restoring the Constitution and the rule of law, science, reason, and non-ideological problem solving, a regulated economy, an egalitarian and forward-looking multicultural society bearing a little humility and curiosity toward other nations and peoples, or as David Brooks and Thomas Friedman would have it, we can now model all of this virtuously rather than hypocritically to the rest of the world. This conviction risks perpetrating the civilizational discourse of democracy that I've just very schematically outlined. It keeps us from seeing what deep religiosity and especially religiously sanctioned inequalities our cozy blankets of secularism keep covered up. It keeps us from seeing what inequalities we take as given, or as natural, or as inevitable. And this last slide between inequality taken as given, or as natural, or as inevitable, is actually an important one to what I'm about to do. Because if you recall, in his infamous blunder, the then president of Harvard, Larry Summers, who's gone on to higher things, didn't say in that famous blunder, women lagged behind men in the sciences because they are by nature intellectually inferior, but because, he said, they're less ambitious and more drawn to children and the family. So what he's doing, of course, is naturalizing the existing order of family and market, generative of certain kinds of results. But he avoided naturalizing gender capacities themselves. And this way of thinking is going to be crucial in what follows. Women's inferiority is very rarely pressed or thematized overtly in secular societies today. Gender difference is, of course, very frequently invoked to explain and legitimize income as well as status inequality. So the questions I want to pursue now are these. What supposedly difference-generated inequalities are frequently taken as given in secular democracies like the US? How are these difference-generated inequalities secured through the place where religion is deposited in putatively secular societies, namely the family? That is, how does a discourse of secularism contribute significantly to the dissimulation of women's persistent inequality in secular societies? I'm going to be arguing that this occurs through two interlocking discursive moves, and probably go further than discourse. I'll say that it occurs through two interlocking moves that also have implication for social order and spatial organization. The first has to do with the deposit of religion in the family in secular societies. And the second has to do with the sacralization of the family, in particular in the US. The fundamental deal of Western secularism, and here it's important to remember that secularism never means the abolition of religion. It's always about the positioning of religion or belief in relation to public life. So the fundamental deal of Western secularism, in which religion is privatized and depoliticized, removed from a formal position of rule or authority in public life, formally removed from the public sphere and from law, formally, not substantively, but formally removed from a public sphere and from law to the sphere of private belief and practice. That fundamental deal is also the deal that I'm going to argue helps to secure women's inequality, substantive inequality, amidst formal legal equality. That fundamental deal of Western secularism that depoliticizes and privatizes religion, deposits it in the private sphere and especially in the family, helps to secure women's inequality. First, because it parallels the privatization and depoliticization of the powers that reproduce gender inequality. Second, because it contributes to the sacralization of the family itself. It doesn't determine that sacralization, but it contributes to it. And third, because the family is the legitimate domain of religion and religious belief and ritual, and religion, of course, historically iterates and legitimates authority, hierarchy, inequality, especially sexual inequality. Doesn't mean it always does that, but it's one of the things that, but it can and often does. And finally, I'm going to suggest that the fundamental deal of Western secularism is also the deal that helps to secure women's inequality, because the family, depoliticized, is construed and lived as a domain of relationality and provision for needs, as opposed to a domain of autonomy and individual rights. The family is a domain of legitimate inequality. And even the classical liberals, Locke, Hobbes, the rest of them, formulated it this way. Okay, but that's the anticipation of the argument. I'm getting way ahead of myself here. To see how this goes, I want to do a couple of things. First, I want to specify a bit more of what I mean by the sacralization of the family in contemporary U.S. life, why I would say that the family's been sacralized. And then I want to review some feminist critiques of the family as a linchpin of women's inequality in liberal democratic capitalist societies. And then I'll consider how liberal legalism formulates secularism as securing women's equality, and finally return to the question of how the Holy Family
shores up the equation of liberal democracy with secularism, how the Holy Family actually helps us to get back to that civilizational discourse, to reinforce our identity as free and equal against a putative opposition in the unsecularized East. Okay, so to the secularization of the family, sacralization of the family in contemporary U.S. life. From left to right, it seems to me today, from both sides of the gay marriage debate, in political religious encomiums to reconstruct and revitalize black fatherhood, in the work-life balance agenda to which most mainstream feminism has been reduced, and much more, the family appears as something of a sacred nugget in American political discourse. It's gone beyond, I think, sentimentalization to sacralization. If 20 years ago the Christian right could monopolize the pro-family platform, this platform is now incredibly crowded. The deliberate political bid by the left in the 80s to become as pro-family as the right has met with stunning success. Today, the nuclear family, I want to suggest, is sacralized across the political spectrum. Consider. Struggling families are the insignia of the economic crisis right now. Not lone individuals, but families are depicted as the suffering, losing jobs, homes, ways of life. More generally, every politician claims to stand for, and every political issue is addressed to families, working families, middle-class families, overtaxed families, struggling families. Indeed, if Barack Obama could include unbelievers in his list of diverse American religious practices, he could not include practitioners of alternative kinship in a list of American ways of life. It would simply be unthinkable. This leads more generally to something I promised at the beginning, my worries over an infatuation that I share with the Obama family. The fascination with its beauty and perfection, its exquisite combination of sexiness and wholesomeness, love and discipline, fun and moral fabric. Of course, we all want to be in that family. Of course. One of the things this does, and it's no minor thing, is redeem images of black families, racial stereotypes of black families as dysfunctional, broken, destructive of masculinity, and so forth. And of course, it also contrasts beautifully with the robotic Bush family, the cracked porcelain of the Clinton marriage, and all the rest of it. But what's really important to remember is that its traditional structure, intensified and perfected over the course of the campaign, was also crucial to making Obama electable. Proof of his centrism, his stability, his solidity, certification of his distance from black cultural stereotypes and from his own complicated lineage. This traditional structure and intensification, now that the Obamas have entered the White House, also tempered Michelle's identification, remember that thesis at Princeton University, with a history of black subordination and exclusion, as she set everything aside to become mom in chief. She's now a woman for whom family comes first, whose primary commitment is now to make sure her perfect children, resulting from her perfect parenting, don't become damaged from being princesses in a palace. But one wonders, what happened to the account in The Audacity of Hope about Barack's encounter just 5 years ago with what he called his wife's barely contained rage at him for the way his professional ambitions left her, as she put it, to raise a family alone? And the insight that this encounter, according to him, in Audacity of Hope, gave him into persistent gender inequalities obtained through sexual divisions of labor, persisting over the generation. Suddenly, that insight is gone. Instead, the Obamas beam perfection, and we bask in the glow of a remarkably traditional picture framed by stay-at-home mothers and grandmothers, Christianity, heterosexuality. Then there's the gay marriage campaign, which, though formulated in terms of civil rights, always individually held and wielded, is promulgated through sacralization of love and family. I don't know how many of you have seen the latest video in the campaign to overturn California's recently passed Proposition 8 called Don't Divorce My Parents. it moves through. Look, I cried. I'm saying I'm part of all this. I'm interpolated by all this, and I'm struggling with the interpolation. But the video moves through Hallmark images of a dozen different gay families in which the children are holding up the sign, "Don't divorce my parents." They are literally begging the state to keep their parents married, both drawing, of course, on national parental anxiety about the impact of divorce on children, on continued nagging worries about the viability of single-parent families, tacitly stigmatizing unmarried, divorced, or single people as lower orders of being. And of course, the sacredness of the family is also part of what's at stake on the other side. Consider even the uproar over Pastor Rick Warren giving the inaugural invocation. What this uproar expressed about the desire for church and state consecration of queer families and for those two to converge at the inauguration. As Richard Kim pointed out in what I thought was a really smart essay in The Nation, instead of us asking what all this Christianity was doing at a state event in a secular nation, why convocations and benedictions, the left demand was for a preacher to advocate a more inclusive picture of the family. And this notably unsecular demand reminds us more generally how routinely and overtly religion plays in the politics of the family. Such politics, where both gendered and queer social equality and freedom is so frequently at stake, is precisely where secularism stutters and falters. It also reminds us that most religious discourse tends to generate and legitimate a distinctly undemocratic social field. That is, the foundation of most religious discourse is unaccountable authority, God, and its institutional structure is hierarchy. Most world religions, of course, also articulate not just sex difference, but women's inferiority. And this is how we get what I want to insist is the non-paradoxical phenomenon of secular religious democratic subjects who simultaneously favor women's political and civil equality and oppose things like abortion, homosexuality, and working mothers. That is, they're for formal political and legal rights and oppose some of the substantive things that would realize, even at the most minimal level, women's equality and freedom. It's this as well that permits somebody like Obama to support civil unions, yet declare in an interview with the Chicago Daily Tribune, and I'm quoting, "I'm a Christian, and so although I try not to have my religious beliefs dominate or determine my political views on this issue, I do believe that tradition, that is the Christian tradition, and my religious beliefs say that marriage is something sanctified between a man and a woman." It's very similar to Ted Kennedy saying that his religion made him personally against abortion, but that the choice should be left to individuals, except that the difference is that the issue of marriage equality, as it's being called, is one in which Obama is saying his religious beliefs, his personal beliefs, actually do come to bear. Now, if religion is one basis on which the family is secured as a sacred institution in the U.S. and through which family politics are brokered, from abortion to adoption to prayer and corporal punishment, it also works the other way around. The family is a site through which religion secures a deep and permanent place in American political culture without challenging a political commitment to secularism. Again, insofar as family and religion are discursively privatized, this privatization gratifies the secular deal. Yet the holy status of the family and its binding by religion is critical not only to public debates and policy formation relating to family issues, but also to individual success. Imagine, it's actually impossible to imagine Obama having won without the wondrous family image to temporize white American racial anxiety. And while the gay marriage campaign may represent the boldest current quest for the blessings of God and state for the Holy Family, It, of course, drew on a much wider discourse that assumes the family as the highest value, that pities those without them, that builds all politics around them, and that often reduces feminism to them. Indeed, this is both the normative order that induced queer politics to press gay marriage to the top of its agenda in the first place, and also made one of the inadvertent effects of that press the further exclusion of non-familial queers from moral intelligibility. But my concern is not just with, nor even mainly with, the powerful and far-reaching normativity of the family when it's consecrated as a holy object, or even with the interlocking effects of family and religion in generating this normativity. Of course, this is part of what makes us such a moralistic culture, one that impeaches a president for lying about blowjobs and that kind of thing. But the prey I'm chasing here is gender inequality, male superordination, under the cover of secularism. And to get there, what I want to do now is return briefly to some of those old feminist critiques of the family in late modern capitalism. And the reason for going there rather than to more recent stuff is precisely because of the virtues of their vice. That is to say, they don't specify by race, by class, by locale, or by anything else what family they're talking about. I mean, some talk about the difference between working class families or differently raced families, but for the most part, the theorizations that I'm going to are simply trying to locate the relationship of the family and to the market and to the sphere of production, capitalism, and how the family operates as a transit point for women's inequality in a sexual division of labor across those two spheres. So even though there's lots to say about what's wrong with these, I want to work with what's useful in them to get at something important about the family as a linchpin of gender inequality. Okay, where am I? Importantly, the critiques I'm talking about, and there's a range of them that include people like Gloria Anzaldúa and Juliet Mitchell and Sheila Robotham and Chodorow and Dinnerstein and others, none of them are treating the family as a mythical eternal form. When I say they don't give it specificity, that does not mean they're treating it as transhistorical and transcultural. Rather, they all recognize that the previous century of capitalism has done something particular to the family. It has reduced the family in the non-agricultural first world to its smallest possible unit, one or two adults plus children, living in a household divested of productive functions, that is, where the household itself is not a scene of production, where one goes out to work and one goes out to get objects that one needs to live. So this is a uniquely modern social order in which family and work are so dramatically separated and where income generation involves going out to work and on the one hand, and household labor, including caring for children, whether it's done in an unpaid fashion or in the paid fashion that Nefertiti was just talking about, is extremely isolated. This is a remarkably recent and unique form of what we call the family. It only arose in the last two centuries in the Euro-Atlantic world, and it only became dominant, really, in the last 100 years. Okay, so what was that feminist critique of the family in late capitalism? That the family is a socially constituted domain of the reproduction of gender inequality, the linchpin of women's substantive inequality in capitalist orders. Why? First, because women's economic dependence in a division between household and the market, where the latter presumes an autonomous adult working full-time, women's economic dependence, if she is doing household labor, caring for children, is almost guaranteed. And yes, of course, I'm talking here about the heterosexual family, but I want to argue that we're not going to find anything so radically different if we go over to my team. Okay, the next thing, women's dependence or inequality as household laborers. I just said that. The complex reproduction of gender that the family produces at psychic and social levels. This is also going to be important. Now, for all that this sounds terribly antiquated, let's just look quickly at the empirics resulting from the family market divide today. In the United States, how many times have you heard this? Women still make 3/4 of what men make for the same work, 77 cents on the dollar. Women do 70% of household labor in households shared with men, all of it when they are single parents. My favorite recent statistic of this sort, I consume these as a kind of, you know, everybody's got their weird habits, but marriage increases housework for women by 7 hours per week and decreases it for men by 1 hour. That's before children, that's without children. So just the act of getting married increases women's, the math is great though, right? Because it means not only that men are doing less, but that they're making really big messes. Or messes that the women can't stand or whatever, I don't know. Okay, so I know, lots of men do a lot of housework and lots of us make big messes. That's not the point. We're looking at the big, gross picture. Okay, so women do 70% of household labor in households shared with men. They do all of it, of course, when they're single parents. So let's go to single parents. 1/3 of U.S. households with children under the age of 18 are single parent households. They'll be the majority soon. 80% of these are headed by women, most of whom are working full-time jobs, most of which are not contoured to family life. Now to those full-time jobs. As of last December, the third month in the so-called financial meltdown, I'm calling it the depression, but as of last December, women now hold the majority of full-time jobs in the market economy. They've held for over 15 years the majority of part-time jobs. And that's because over 80% of the recent layoffs were layoffs of men, and that's because of the gender divide in things like building cars and other productive labor as opposed to service work, which has been laid off much less. Okay, but I'm losing the thread. I was trying to build a sense of accumulating work for women here. Okay, so women make 3/4 of what men make for the same work. They do 70% of household labor in households shared with men. They do all of it as single parents. 1/3 of the households in the U.S. are single parent households. 80% of those are headed by women. Women are holding a majority of the actual number of jobs in the market economy. Women do 85% of the labor, paid and unpaid, related to caring for the elderly and infirm. Okay, so let's grasp what this adds up to. Women in the United States today, and these are the only the ones the census actually captures. I suspect they're not capturing, I know they're not, it's not capturing a lot of undocumented workers. Women in the US today are doing the majority of all labor, household and market labor, for less pay, less recognition, less status, with less support, while men continue to occupy the top of the economic, political, and social status and economic positions. Equally important, this is the order in which the next generation is learning what gender is and gender does. But this is only part of the story of how the family reproduces gender inequality. More often forgotten from those old feminist critiques are the kinds of things you get from, I know the people under 30 are just rolling their eyes at this point, but I'm just going to remind you of what people like Chodorow and Dinnerstein and Gilligan did with psychoanalysis and object relations, which was really think hard analytically about how girls get socially produced, not just for mothering, but for selflessness and accommodation and cooperation in relation to much more individuated and competitive male egos as a result of the social sexual psychodynamics in the family, whether one does objects relations or more traditional Freudian analysis. Then there's the critique as well from many of these old feminists, that the family is a site of social and political conservatism, from being holders and purveyors of inherited wealth and poverty, to the ways that the family replaces concerns with public good, often with the question of what's good for me and mine, whether thinking about taxes or schools or a variety of other things. And finally, there's the aspect of the critique that I've always been the most fascinated by,
which is the kind of thing that Juliet Mitchell, Eli Zaretsky, Ansel Dua, Robotham, Hortense Spillers all emphasize, which is the emotionally overburdened quality of this family shrunk to the smallest possible unit with all the demands for intimacy, love, caring, and connectedness in a social order, a political economy that features none of those things. This is the pithy way that Robotham put it in Man's Consciousness, Woman's World. As the family becomes smaller in size, its emotional load becomes heavier. The monogamous nuclear family has become such a preposterous ideal that it sags with the weight of its unrealized hopes almost before it creates itself. And she adds, the family under capitalism carries an intolerable weight, all the rags and bones and bits of old iron the capitalist commodity system can't use. Within the family, women are carrying the preposterous contradiction of love in a loveless world, providing capitalism with the human relations it cannot maintain in the world of work. That was Sheila Robotham in Man's Consciousness, Woman's World. Now, of course, again, these critiques are woefully unspecific about class and race and location, but as I said, what's wrong with them in this regard is also what permits their insight into the production and reproduction of gender and gender inequality at the site of the family in late capitalism. It allows them to theorize what the propping of the ideology and the institution of the family has meant for the persistence of gender inequality. Now, of course, the contemporary feminist rejoinder to these critiques, there are many, but one of them is they overstated the bad, they understated the good. That is, they understated the deep value, deep meaning, deep sustenance, and joy that families can bring. Or the claim is these were utopian critiques. The critique exceeded what we could possibly bring into being. These critiques really did call for either the radical transformation of the family, absolute gender equality, or the abolition of it. We were big on abolition back then. Note, very few rejoinders to these critiques say, oh, equality in and through the family is after all quite possible, and the family has nothing whatsoever to do with securing women's inequality across the sexual division of labor between the family and the market, and these critiques were simply dead wrong. Very few modern feminist rejoinders would say that. I don't underestimate the power and the pull of family ties and passions. Most of us feel these as deeply as we feel anything, whether toward families of origin or families of our own making. But the radical claim of these old critiques is that these ties and passions are social, that they're not simply natural. They're discursively and ideologically produced. Moreover, the claim is these ties bind precisely because they're all we've got. They bind because others don't, because capitalism organizes social space according to very nearly opposite values, competitive, alienated, exploitative, abusive, etc. So the claim is that it's not merely ideology or discourse that naturalizes the family in defiance of all the historical and cultural variety that would give the lie to such naturalization, or sentimentalizes the family in defiance of all the horror stories as well as ordinary deformation that families generate. The point of these critiques is also that the family remains the exclusive and indeed radically overburdened site of intimacy, social life, care, and companionship for most in modern or late capitalist societies. So no matter how ragged and broken and depressing and claustrophobic or even violent, no matter how persistent in producing and reproducing women's inequality, family appears for many, if not for most, better than nothing. Now, carrying these analyses with us, I'm going to tack back to our secularism and equality question. So you just now have to hold this critique of the family as a site of women's inequality and a scene for the reproduction of gender inequality as we ask, how does secularism get equated with women's equality in the liberal democratic imagination? First, there's a general presumption that the historical separation of church and state was a pervasively democratizing move, one that included democracy for women. That presumption that the historical separation of church and state was a pervasively democratizing move gets facilitated as a presumption by Locke's refutation of political patriarchalism in the first treatise, gets facilitated by the French Revolutionary repudiation of state religion along with the women's emancipatory movement. So there's a kind of emancipation by association here, but one, as I said, that feminist historians, including the paper I mentioned by Joan Scott, the title I won't try to pronounce again, that these historians are actually taking apart this assumption, the idea that secularism ever, that the separation of church and state was one that generated gender equality or entailed it or ever had it on its agenda. Second way that secularism gets equated with women's equality in the liberal democratic imagination is through the presumption that religion is inherently sexist and liberal legalism is not, or is only contingently so. This assumption that religion is inherently sexist and liberal legalism is not, or is only contingently so, in turn involves two further assumptions given voice long ago by John Stuart Mill, but recently kind of heated up again by Susan Okun in Is Multiculturalism Bad for Women? And these two further assumptions go like this, and as I say, both Mill and Okun voice these. The first is that liberal legalism secures our governance by the rule of law, which is itself free of religion. That is, that being governed by the rule of law is what liberal legalism guarantees, and that governance by the rule of law is free of religion, and that the rule of law itself subtends all other powers, so that it's really rule. Religion is removed from it. And the second is that this rule of law inevitably progresses toward gender neutrality and gender equality. So it's divested of religion, and it's progressing toward gender neutrality and gender equality. The assumption here is that religion, tradition, custom harbor inequality. Liberal legalism is its antidote. Or put the other way, law is non-religious, and law prevails above religion. Now, there's plenty to question in these logics and the worldview they articulate, but the only thing I want to focus on is what the rule of law doesn't dislodge. And that's the very node of women's subordination that I've been considering, the sacralized family. Where a sexual division of labor between market and family and within the family routinely burdens women with more work at less pay and less freedom, where conventional gender norms are reproduced and circulated, and so forth. If the family is a crucial vehicle for women's inequality in the face of their formal equality, but remains the religious nugget in several senses at the heart of secular society, how does this go? The family is the recognized and acceptable domain in which religion is practiced, in which it's accepted as a moral compass, and transmitted. That's what it means to say, I come from a Christian family, or I come from a Jewish family, or we are Muslims. Family is also constructed and consecrated in U.S. discourse. I'm going to put it that loosely. It's constructed, consecrated, if not held together, by religion. It's, of course, one of the great hues and cries of the Christian right, that it's the decline of religion that is the cause of the decline of the family. But it's not just the Christian right. I think this is also why queers are seeking religious sanction of our unions. We're not seeking the religious consecration of our sexual practices or our cultural productions or our public institutions or our communities, only of our unions. Moreover, the family, of course, is also taken to be the very basic unit of secular and religious society, even for extreme neoliberals. It was Margaret Thatcher who famously declared, when she was introducing neoliberalism to the bigger world,
There is no such thing as society. There are only individuals, cardinal rule of neoliberalism. And then she added in this kind of dot, dot, dot fashion, there is no society, such thing as society. There are only individuals and families. And so you've got that reinstantiation of the family as the basic unit, which for a neoliberal was tricky. I mean, it's very tricky, but very telling. So what I'm saying is family is in several senses a religious node at the heart of the social within liberalism. It has sacred status. It's the legitimate domain of religion. It transmits religion. It's consecrated by religion and understood by many to be held together by religion. This means that family is key in the trick of secularism that allows us to proclaim our fundamental commitment to egalitarianism in contrast with non-secular societies while maintaining religiously underwritten inegalitarianism understood as sexual difference. Do you want me to say that sentence again?
Yeah,
I thought so. I needed to say it again for myself. This means... If the family is in several senses a religious node at the heart of the social and liberalism, I'm going to say two sentences again. It has a sacred status, it's the legitimate domain of religion, it transmits religion, it's consecrated by religion, and it's understood by many to be held together by religion. And that's all legitimate, that's part of being secular because it's not public, it's private, it's family. This means that family is really key in what I'm calling the ruse of secularism, or the discourse about secularism, I'll put it that way, that allows us to proclaim our fundamental commitment to egalitarianism. We really believe in our equality and are committed to gender equality in contrast to non-secular societies where they don't. To proclaim our commitment to fundamental egalitarianism while at the same time maintaining religiously underwritten gender inequality, understood as sexual difference. As a sacred node and a harbor for religion at the heart of secular society, what I'm calling the Holy Family is what legitimately reproduces inequality without the force of law, a force that we secularists reserve to our understanding of theocracies. Theocracies write gender inequality into law. We don't. We just have this other trick I'm suggesting. As such, the family reproduces inequalities and exclusions that liberals constantly insist we're done with, insofar as women and queers have formal rights as individuals. Inequalities and exclusions that we pin on non-secular societies as their essence. They're by nature as theocracies or unsecular, sexist, misogynist, homophobic, etc. Put another way, to the extent that gender and sexual inequality are acceptable givens in the family, the place where natural differences, so-called, govern and are protected, the sacredness of the family is like the protective veil for these givens. One plank of Juliet Mitchell's critique in Psychoanalysis and Feminism. That's one book that actually does hold up. Some of these others are really painful to read, and I'm just giving you what's useful in them and not suggesting you have to go off and read them, but her book does hold up. One plank of her critique is that the family reproduces and secures gender inequalities that capitalism and liberalism shred. That is, capitalism really erodes the basis for gender inequality, and she argues so does liberalism, and she argues that the family reproduces and secures gender inequalities ideologically with gender roles and so forth, materially by maintaining a sexual division of labor between family and economy. But she argues, and this is her language, the family is redundant, she's British, from both, it did mean something different, right, if you're redundant there, it's being unemployed. But it is redundant from both a kinship perspective, meaning the function it served for mandatory exogamy, she's drawing on Levi-Strauss, and it's redundant from both a kinship perspective and the perspective of capitalism, because there's no productivity in the household. What I would add to her critique is that it may be precisely at this moment of redundancy that the family becomes holy, sacred, unquestionable, that becomes its identity and part of what maintains it. Okay, so I'm done, and what I want to remind you of is that I am neither arguing for the abolition of the family nor for the abolition of secularism. Rather, what I'm trying to get at is the complex circuitry between a discourse about secularism. No. What I'm trying to get at is the complex circuitry between the operations of secularism, the sacralization of the family in U.S. culture, and gender inequality. Those are the three things I'm trying to map the connections between. Why? Both so that we can break out of the civilizational and imperial discourse in which secularism is equated with gender equality and with liberating women, the imperial discourse that I began with that was appropriated by the Bushies, used by them, especially Laura Bush, she was particularly good on this, in Afghanistan. But that not only liberal feminists, but many others have also been caught up in, a civilizational discourse that I think we all are often quite susceptible to. So that's one reason I've been trying to get at the circuitry between secularism, the sacralization of the family in U.S. culture, and gender inequality. And the other reason is to see how this discourse obscures recognition of our own sacred social institutions and the preservation work that those institutions do for gender inequality. Thank you.